you know, I hate the word theme. I never know what people mean. Like, is violence a theme? Then that's the theme of every American film. Is family a theme? Then that's also the theme of every American film. I don't know, you can probably find 20 million themes in Star Wars. Who could possibly claim that there's only one theme to Star Wars? Me. I can. There's one theme to Star Wars, and that theme is technology.
The Techno Union Army is at your disposal, Count.
So let's start at the beginning. Star Wars begins with the awe of technology. People were not only awed at the imaginary technology of a Star Destroyer, they were also in awe of this shot. Have you ever heard those apocryphal stories about early film spectators who saw the Lumiere Brothers film, a train arriving at a station, and jumped out of the way because they thought it was a real train coming out of the wall to hit them? The story may or may not be true. In fact, it's definitely not true, but the fact that it has become a part of the canon of cinema lore tells us a lot about how we don't think of cinema. We don't think of cinema as being real in the sense of a train actually coming out of the wall and hitting us. But by reversing that train arriving shot, that foundational shot of cinema, and having the train recede away from us into outer space, reveals just as much about how we do think of cinema. We do think of cinema as opening a portal into another world, one which we pretend to believe in. We don't believe, but we willingly suspend disbelief. Anyway, Star Wars can be seen as a meditation on technology. Not only are there machines that look like humans, but there are humans that look like machines. Ask yourself, what do we actually see of the Empire? We see soldiers, officers, we see Vader himself, but we don't see cities. We don't see planets. We see artificial environments, we see ships, and on these ships, people who are one with their environment. Look at the sleek black and white costumes. Now look at the sleek black and white walls. These are not people. They're festoons, they're buttons, they're cogs in a very well-oiled machine. They're programmed what to say and what to do. But Star Wars is always doing this. It's showing us how people are continuous with their environments. It's showing us how the architecture of environments become the architecture of social relations. This motif expresses a very simple idea. It's the idea of evolution, how creatures adapt to better fit in with their environments. By visually extending this motif from the natural world into the social world of human life, it expresses a deeply felt fear that the human experiment will be hijacked by a convenient authoritarianism that turns humanity into machinery, vessels of the wills of others, speakers of the words of others.
That's your uncle talking.
Servants of a power that only serves itself, machines that obey our programming. Already in the very first Star Wars film, there's an elegant visual expression of a deeply felt fear that unless we nip this authoritarian impulse in the bud, we will have a galactic space dictatorship forever. These films don't have to explain in dialogue what they're about. They don't have to tell us what the Empire does or why it's evil, because they communicate their ideas in a much richer way by using images to speak in the universal sublingual language of dreams. And that's what the cinema is. That's what it does best. It communicates in sounds and in images. Framing can tell the story. Editing can tell the story. And when it reaches a point of transcendence, it can communicate ideas that don't fit into words and could never fit into words. Words are sort of like cups. Meaning is the water that spilleth over. Dreams, for example, have too much meaning. When they're translated into words, they get flattened and trivialized. Words usually speak to the conscious mind, but images speak to the subconscious mind. They can hypnotize us. They can say far more than we realize. So, in The Last Jedi, when Rose goes,
And who do you think these people are? There's only one business in the galaxy that'll get you this rich.
I remember thinking, oh, she must be talking about venture capital or, you know, some kind of speculative finance. I mean, these people's lives probably revolve around a stock market of some kind, you know? Like, this is the industry of all industries. You know, they deal in deals. Their business is business. They use money to make money. Wrong.
War.
Selling weapons to the First Order.
So now, this is a very different logic than the previous Star Wars films. Suddenly, this movie is making a statement. A flat claim that fits very comfortably in words. This is a claim about a fantasy world, sure, but who can help thinking of this as a statement on our world too? And it's a claim which isn't particularly insightful. I mean, there's this thing in our world called the military-industrial complex, and it's just that. It's a complex of forces. It's a network of political and economic and even cultural forces. I mean, in our world, the market itself creates a demand for war. It's a need which creates its own supply, and politicians serve the market while funding militaries around the world to stimulate that industry. It's not as simple as like, oh, there's guys here who like run a factory, they sell arms to the First Order. And that's just one industry. I mean, why focus on the arms industry? There's also the energy industry.
With our current fuel consumption, there's a very limited amount of time that we can stay out of range of those Star Destroyers.
Why would the richest industry be arms when there's such a complex economy fueling this huge galaxy? So while we're on the topic, let me just ask you another question. What is the First Order? I mean, what is any of this? If you have to read it online somewhere to find out, then that doesn't count. Answer me using only details from the text itself, meaning the three films. What is the First Order? The Disney Star Wars films are incredibly sparse in their world building. We never really find out what the First Order is, how it rose to power, how much power it has. One thing that's great about the saga films is that they express vast world building effortlessly. Say what you want about George Lucas as a writer, but if you think he's anything but one of the best to ever do it, one of the best to ever pick up a pen and write a story, if you think he's anything less than the Homer of the 20th century, then you are mistaken. But seriously though, show me another writer who can tell you everything you need to know in 30 seconds.
What is it?
It's your father's lightsaber. This is the weapon of a Jedi Knight. Not as clumsy or random as a blaster. An elegant weapon for a more civilized age. For over 1,000 generations, the Jedi Knights were the guardians of peace and justice in the Old Republic. Before the Dark Times. Before the Empire.
He got all that in 30 seconds? Yo, let this kid cook for another 30 seconds. Go.
How did my father die?
A young Jedi named Darth Vader, who was a pupil of mine until he turned to evil, helped the Empire hunt down and destroy the Jedi Knights. He betrayed and murdered your father. Now the Jedi are all but extinct. Vader was seduced by the dark side of the Force.
How many seconds are in a film? A New Hope is 2 hours and 1 minute long, so that's 7,260 seconds. Do you know how many more seconds you'll have if you devote 60 whole seconds to exposition? You'd still have 7,200 seconds. But that doesn't mean you can be frivolous with those 60 seconds, okay? You'll want to go ahead and make those some of the most interesting 60 seconds in the whole damn movie, layered with subtext that rewards rewatching after you see the prequels. In 60 seconds, I know what a lightsaber is, what a Jedi Knight is. We know the Jedi Knights are extinct, they're gone. We know there was once this thing called a Republic. We don't know what that is yet, but we know that Obi-Wan thinks that that was a more civilized age. We know it existed in peace for over 1,000 generations. Then, all at once, something called the Empire appeared, took over the galaxy and hunted down all the Jedi. We know that Luke's father was one of those slain Jedi. We know that Darth Vader was once a Jedi who turned evil. We don't yet know what the Force is, but we do know that it has a dark side and it can seduce people. To communicate that much information in such a small amount of time is one thing, but to do it in a way that is personal to these characters, dramatically interesting, and makes me care about these characters more than I did before this scene, while also doing it in such a way that establishes Obi-Wan's perspective and his lie, it's a virtuosic feat of screenwriting. So let me ask you, how many more of those 7,200 remaining seconds should we give him for exposition? I mean, exposition is supposed to be boring, right? We're supposed to get it out of the way and get right into the plot. You know, I mean, there's literally 2 billion deaths to get through in this movie. We can't sit around in this shot reverse shot scene forever, right? So how many more seconds should we give him? 15 seconds? Okay, let's give him 15 seconds.
The Force?
The Force is what gives the Jedi his power. It's an energy field created by all living things. It surrounds us and penetrates us. It binds the galaxy together.
And now we know what the Force is. All right, the point I'm trying to make here is that this calm and quick scene makes the galaxy that this story takes place in feel immense. It's a massive place with a lot of history and a lot of things going on everywhere. By contrast, the galaxy in the sequel trilogy feels puny. I mean, the richest people sell arms? You're telling me there isn't any other industry that does better than the arms industry? I mean, look at the chase sequence. Is that the entirety of the First Order and the entirety of the Resistance? That's it? It feels like we know everything we need to know even before coming into the theater. We never get a scene like this one explaining where the First Order came from or what the New Republic is, what the Knights of Ren are, who the f*** Snoke is. You know, people love to hate the fact that
somehow Palpatine returned.
But really, the First Order is just the Empire coming back. And the Rebels, which destroyed it last time, rebranded themselves as the Resistance for some reason, just so that they could stage the same drama all over again, first as tragedy, then as farce. The worst part of this is that it reduces the mythological logic of Star Wars to a sociological one. I mean, even if this works as an allegory, this film still doesn't deal in symbolism. It doesn't turn concepts into images. It doesn't speak to us non-verbally. This is commentary. The dream is flattened. The cup runneth not over. I want to be clear. I'm not naive. I know you can't divorce politics from art. I mean, imagine how cringe it would be to say something like,
"The old Star Wars movies weren't political. These new ones are so political."
The original Star Wars films are very political. They're explicitly political. I mean, they're radically political. They advocate for terrorism, if you read them literally. But that's just it. You can't read them too literally. You have to read them symbolically. And I cannot say for sure that Disney reads them symbolically, which gives me pause.
People are rising up all over the galaxy. Oh, we did it.
We did it.
Star Wars has always been a self-conscious gesture towards mythmaking. It seeks to be universal, to speak to the collective unconscious. Star Wars is a fairy tale, not a manifesto. Its theme is evolution, not revolution. Hey, but wait, didn't I say there was just one theme? Oh, right, yeah, technology. I think it's really telling that one of the few POV shots we get in all of these films is that of a machine. So, right off the bat in the first Star Wars film, machines have subjectivity, they have individuality, they have desire, they have flaws, they have personality, they have mortality. For all intents and purposes, they're people. But if machines are people, then what makes a droid a droid?
We seem to be made to suffer. It's our lot in life.
Suffering. Don't humans suffer too?
Leads to suffering.
Of course they do. In fact, isn't that what makes a human a human?
If you're suffering as much as I am, please tell me.
No. That's what makes a human a slave. A slave, in other words, a machine. Machines are victims. they're also the proletariat. They're certainly second-class citizens. They're also possessions. Sometimes they're appreciated, but usually they're not. To put it really simply, machines are slaves to their programming. They're incapable of changing themselves, of overcoming their automation.
It's against my programming to impersonate a deity.
There is no apotheosis for a droid. In other words, they cannot adapt, they cannot grow, they cannot evolve. It's paradoxically our capacity to become more than human, which makes us human. This is a vision of humanity which requires the protagonist to have an arc. But Star Wars also is not naive. It shows us how people can also become slaves. It shows us how people with weak minds can become dehumanized tools. People sometimes point out that there's actually very little automation in Star Wars. There's always a human, or a droid, doing some anonymous work in the background, pressing buttons, reading reports. But that's the point. Under the Empire, humans are the automation. Humans are the buttons. They are the machine. You know, we never see a city under direct Imperial control, except for Cloud City, very briefly. And that's a world of deceit. It's a world of opportunists, of capitalists, whose hands are tied, who want to help, but are also programmed by the needs of the market. They're easily bribed and threatened by those in power, and yet they still mean well. And if you mean well, then that means you have a limit. In the Star Wars universe, breaking out of your programming is the single bravest thing a person can do, but it's also a painful thing. It's never an easy passage. We resist it, but heroism is doing just that. Defying your conditioning, your mental habits, going against the grain. So with that immense amount of ado behind us, let's jump right in and talk about how the original trilogy approaches character arcs.